Official welcome to today's webinar to all of you. I think today the focus is on what I would call post-COVID. What are the opportunities and if I can use that word, challenges we are going to have, we are having, and we are coming out of, if I can use that word. I think the purpose of today is also to hear from many people who are going to be participating, but I think we are also privileged to honor Mr. Agarwal, who I think will be joining shortly, who is taken over as the Special Secretary Logistics from Mr. Sivasailam. And I think we are also indeed delighted that we have Mr. Srivatsava, so who is from Niti Aayog, and I think who comes from the civil aviation sector as well. So, you know, we are very glad to have you here with us, sir. And of course, we have, I think, Professor Janat Shah, whom is not new to people who have been associated with the logistics sector. I think he has been a mentor to many of us and many a mentor to many institutions to whom which he has been involved. So again, welcome, sir. And of course, I have my colleague Rizwan, who is the chairman of the CII National Ports and Shipping Committee and who is the CEO and MD of DP World. So I think Mr. Mohan will finally cover also from his perspective in terms of being a member of the National Committee on Logistics and the CEO of Mini Storage Solutions. So I think, like I said, the purpose of today is to try and understand what are the opportunities and challenges we will have post-COVID. But I think the more important thing, if I can say so, is let us not forget that logistics as a sector was an essential service, was operational, whether COVID was there or not, I would say was a very important link as it happened. In fact, we from CII, Institute of Logistics, and personally myself and so many of those who are on today's meeting, have been involved in terms of making sure not just essential services, but also goods keep moving and things start happening even during the lockdown. And as we are now coming to the unlock phase, I think we are looking forward to the future with much more hope and much more expectations. Having said that, I think Mr. Agarwal will definitely speak about it, but I think what's also important for us to understand is that this sector has its challenges, but has also huge opportunities. And let us not forget that we have to use this time to make the changes. And I think there is the long-awaited logistics policy also, which has announced the budget, which should hopefully come out soon. And therefore, this conference gives us an opportunity to not only understand perspectives, but also debate on how we can move forward and what can we do to make the difference as far as the support for this sector, actions in this sector, and last but not the least, what is the way in which policies can be framed to make this a growth sector. Coming to the Institute of Logistics, I think we have been fully involved, or I would say active during the phase of the lockdown. I think we have supported both the essential services and the transport sector in making sure we come back. But the long-term focus hasn't changed. We still want to be taking the leadership position with regard to supporting the sector in terms of skilling, in terms of providing, if I can say so, the latest thinking and also preparing us for the future. And as we go down that path, I think we have been involved in looking at outsourcing as to how we can increase the percentage of outsourcing. India still is the lowest percentage in terms of both private sector and now obviously from the government outsourcing taking place. I mean, we are at about 30% is what we think. Of course, we don't have a direct study where we have got the data as compared with, let us say, US or Europe, where it's in the range of 80%. The second issue is in terms of multimodal. How do we integrate things? How do we create, common documents? How do we create approach to making a difference with regard to the way we deal with people? I think COVID has taught us good to have, but I would say a must have. And that means that we need to talk to each other through different forms, as we are doing today, if I can say so, rather than meeting in person as what would have happened with the logistics summit. So I think from the Institute of Logistics, we want to take the lead in terms of each of these. I think you're well aware, we've already introduced the Scale Awards, which is maybe the first of its kind in terms of recognizing what the industry players and the user sectors can bring in terms of a new age approach. I think going forward, we will continue to play this role, not just in terms of activities, but also in terms of providing know-how, knowledge, and support. And I know Mr. Agarwal is not here yet, but I think it's very important for me to mention that we do have the tie-up with with the logistics division of the Ministry of Commerce, and we continue to work with them in terms of supporting in all the manners possible. In fact, the moment Mr. Agarwal joined, in fact, he joked with me saying his first call was to the Institute, considering how we had been working with his predecessors, and we will continue to work with them as well. So I know that we have quite a few speakers on this panel, so I do not want to take too much time. I will be obviously coming in between once each of the speakers they give their address. So I would now like to hand over to Mr. Janet Shah. I will now request Mr. Janet Shah to give his address, please.
Thank you, Mr. Dinesh, and good morning to all the participants, leaders of supply chain, logistics and supply chain. First, I want to compliment Mr. Dinesh, NCF Institute of Logistics, for hosting this digital conference. Because I think all of us know that the post-COVID world is going to be very different from a pre-COVID world. And though it's obvious that as a logistics professionals and leaders, we're going to play an important role, I think it's good to do this conversation where we try and understand that in what way we can play an important role in the time to come. Essentially, first, I think it'll be important to understand what way COVID-19 is different from our past disruptions. I think as India, as a country, we are used to disruptions. There have been cyclones. For example, Orissa got affected with cyclone. Recently, Calcutta got affected. Bombay just got saved. In the past, SARS have been there. There have been disruption in the country and the world. But I guess what is different about COVID is the scale, the scope, and the pace. Just in few months, the entire world has been affected. So it's earlier we used to say, if West Bengal is affected or Kerala is affected, somewhere it had an impact, but somehow we didn't, so that's the reason this whole scale, scope, and pace, all the industries have been affected. The second part is what is unusual is both demand and supply have been affected. Traditionally, usually some part get affected. Here, from a demand perspective, we find all the industries, maybe except for a healthcare and a food, which have not been affected. Healthcare have been affected in a positive way. Suddenly we need lot many PPE, lot many medicine, lot many beds. But for most other sectors, there's a huge demand slump and lot of uncertainty. But simultaneously, we are affected on a supply side. On a supply side, we are affected both on the parts front and people front. Usually we worry about saying we are one part of our supply chain in terms of, some parts are not available. But suddenly now we are worried about people supply chain also, that ensuring that, right skill of people are available without compromising of health. So I think somewhere this is a very different kind, and I think it has created a lot of awareness about several issues. And as a logistics professionals, I would just focus on three areas which I think it has created awareness to all of us, whether you are in logistics or any part of business or not even business. First, I think the importance of logistics. I think at no point in time we had world leaders talking about logistics. I think you hear any world leader today, whether our prime minister, anybody, they would talk about logistics and supply chain management. Same is true of our CEOs. Earlier, as a logistics professional, we used to keep complaining that we are not on the radar of CEO. their logistics, not a boardroom function. But today you ask any CEO, the first thing they keep talking about is the logistics. So somewhere, you know, it's interesting that how we have come on the forefront, and I'm going to come back in the end. We'll have to make sure that we remain on the forefront. We remain on radar. What do we need to do about it? Second part is that globally, everybody has recognized that we had created certain, you know, supply chains which were not sustainable. You know, we created supply chain which were very efficient, but they were all heavily concentrated in a one region and one country. So for all global companies, China accounted for a significant part of the chain. And suddenly, world has realized that it has created so much vulnerability. And somewhere in a post-COVID world, it's not necessarily we'll go back to deglobalization, but I think at least people are going to talk about a regional blocks. People are going to talk about at least resilient supply chain where I have at least two sources of supply. So people are going to look at logistics supply chain very differently in a post-COVID. And third, the importance of information. That whole idea that I need to have information and transparency about where my goods are, where my material is. You know, most of us didn't know what was happening before tier one. Now we are saying, unless we know what is happening in a tier two, what is happening in a tier three, we will not be able to manage our logistics and supply chain effectively. So there are three key learnings. One, role of logistics. Second, vulnerability of global supply chains. And the third, importance of transparency and information in general. Now, what does this mean to us? You know, so first, I think I would say, as a logistics professional, we need to take advantage and say, how do we make sure that our function remains a boardroom function? I think traditionally, we have looked at our job and everybody looked at much more from a cost minimization perspective. Instead of that, if you're able to look at us as a revenue assurance, saying that, look, without, you know, proper risk management on the part of a logistics function, we'll not be able to assure revenue. So somewhere, how do we make sure that in a post-COVID world, as a logistics professionals, we remain as a part of a boardroom discussion and we remain business focused and business looks at logistics as an important profession in the time to come. You know, so I think it's a great opportunity for us to deliver during this period and prepare for future. Second, somewhere, you know, how do we make sure that when world is re-looking at their supply chains, how do we position India as an important player in this? Now let's recognize this. Today, every global company is asking this question, how do I relocate my supply chain? As I mentioned earlier, it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, closing walls. Some of it would happen, but people are also talking about creating alternative supply chain. So it's not necessarily, you know, it's a 0-1 game, but they are going to look at alternate supply chains. And unfortunately today, India is not on radar. You know, that's a reality. Somewhere we need to make sure, and that's where as a logistics professional, we have an important role to play. That we need to make sure that we are an important candidate. What do we need to do? We need to first make sure we are efficient. Unfortunately today, I think as you know, Mr. Dinesh also talked about it, and we have talked in past, our logistics costs are significantly higher compared to other countries. Somewhere we'll have to make sure we make supply chain and logistics more efficient, but simultaneously we make it more resilient. We should be able to assure to world that we have those best practices in place so that we'll be efficient as well as resilient, so that we become important, you know, player in a global supply chain. And simultaneously, we make sure that we work on a technology, mainly digital technology, so that we are able to assure that the information availability and transparency is there. And there we have a huge advantage because we have provided IT services to our world. So I think we have a great opportunity to play that role, provided we put our act together collectively. And that's where I think this event is very important. And I was very impressed with the kind of, you know, people Mr. Dinesh has put together, even in the inaugural function. So we have a government. So we have Mr. Pawan Kumar Agarwal. We have Mr. Anil Srivastava representing the government part because they will have to play a major role. We have an industry, you know, Mr. Dinesh himself, Mr. Rizwan, both on the shipper side, the user as well as service provider. And we have academia. So I think it'll be important that somewhere all of us, you know, CI Logistics playing a role where all of us get together and say, can we look at this as a great opportunity where we can look at future in terms of efficiency as well as resilience. And so that we remain, we become an important candidate when world is looking at alternatives to China. So thank you. And I look forward to the conversations where during the day where we debate this issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shah. I really appreciate that as always. I think you have brought in the new thought of what I would call how do we adjust to the new normal of the deglobalization. So thank you for that. Can I now request Rizwan to give his special address, please? I mean, Rizwan needs no introduction, but as I said, I think he is the CEO of DP World, and I think he has personally seen what has happened during the COVID, where we had been on many calls together. So Rizwan, over to you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much, Mr. Dinesh and Professor Janet Shah, for sharing your thoughts and insights. Thank you for the CII team to organize this event at a very, very critical juncture where we actually move from COVID to post-COVID in that sense, and the adjustment to the supply chains and logistics as an essential service to serve our industry and our export needs. A very warm welcome to Mr. Pawan Agarwal, who I'm sure will join us very soon. Special Secretary Logistics, Mr. Anil Srivastava, Mission Director, Niti Aayog, Mr. S.A. Mohan, and Mr. Mahidar, and all distinguished guests to this virtual logistics summit. Thank you very much, Mr. Dinesh, to organize this. So as I think my fellow speakers have actually mentioned, business has obviously been impacted quite negatively because of this pandemic. Reduced demand, completely changed supply chains in terms of sourcing patterns. Despite this drop in volumes, logistics facilities, you know, all across India faced a lot of congestion, actually, which is quite ironic, coupled with a lot of other trends as consignees were not able to actually take deliveries. There was inadequate trucking capacity in that sense because of the shortfall of manpower, and the employee force continues to migrate back to their towns and villages, you know, facing the entire you know, industry with a lot of issues around that. The very encouraging news, and I must actually mention the positive side, is that the railways has actually emerged as a very reliable and a resilient mode of transport and played a very major role as an example in reducing congestion at India's ports. Since it limits the interpersonal interactions, it has you know, much higher throughput capacity as compared to other modes of transport, you know, like road, for example. It actually operated pretty smoothly during this lockdown and provided this much needed relief. In fact, we actually witnessed a 30 to 40% increase in Exim volumes moving by railways, you know, during April and May as compared to the other modes of transport, right? As my fellow speakers also mentioned, the logistics sector will continue to be, you know, extremely important, you know, for the revival of the economy and make sure that our exports, you know, become even more globally competitive, right? Making us self-reliant, self-sufficient, as advocated by the Honorable Prime Minister on various occasions, the logistics sector would actually play a very, very important role in supporting not just the domestic trade, but also connecting India to the rest of the world in that sense, right? As Prof. Janet Shah mentioned, right, you know, major industries and global companies are looking for alternate locations to establish their manufacturing and processing facilities, right? And an efficient logistics sector can be very, very instrumental to attract investment in the country. I'll give you an example of a couple of consumer manufacturing companies who actually approached us, you know, to provide the logistics support if they actually set up manufacturing in India. And they were not looking at manufacturing in India versus, for example, Vietnam or versus in Indonesia. They were actually looking at India and Vietnam, and they were actually looking at exporting 90% of their produce in that sense. So, you know, we are actually, you know, making some impact in terms of an alternate, you know, manufacturing facility as compared to some of our traditional competitors in Southeast Asia and other places in that sense. And as industries, they try to decouple from China, you know, these sourcing patterns are poised to change and multiple sources are going to get activated. And therefore, for us to actually be competitive at this stage is critically important. And likewise, you know, there are demand vagaries as well, where, you know, traditional markets, you know, remain uncertain for our exporters in that sense. This will bring about even more complexity in our customer supply chain and a very, very larger responsibility, I would say, of integrated logistics service providers, most of them were on this call, to be able to handle this complexity, you know, this vagaries of demand, as well as in terms of the sourcing patterns changing at short notice. And therefore, the elasticity of operations will become even more critical going forward, actually, and how, you know, we as integrated logistics service providers are able to actually handle those changes at very, very short notice sometimes, and be able to proact as well by actually ensuring that we are privy and we have the necessary means to get the data ahead of time in that sense, right? Customers are also looking at ensuring provenance and contactless handling of their cargo in these times, right? They want to actually pinpoint the source of goods. They want to actually have proof and evidence that, you know, the number of times cargo is actually handled is minimized. And we will actually have to ensure that automation is braced even more so in these times to be able to achieve these requirements of our customers in that sense, right? And of course, this will actually lead to many, many other changes that we will need to bring about. For example, in the warehousing designs, you know, logistics marketplaces, encouraging the use of technologies such as blockchain, IoT on a very, very large scale. Because what this pandemic essentially has done for us is that some of the trends that we already saw in the past few years, right, will have to have a lot of acceleration going forward now. So you know, companies are getting digitized faster, for example, and the logistics industry, you know, being a derived demand industry, would have to embrace this change at a much, much more faster pace to keep in touch with customers' requirements in that sense. I'll just touch a little bit on the reforms and the interventions needed by both the stakeholders on this call, but also in terms of the government at large, per se. You know, my fellow speakers also mentioned about reduction of total logistics cost. I mean, you know, we're at 13-14%, depending on what the data actually says and how we actually cut the data. We need to bring it to 8-9%. We need to actually make sure that this cost of logistics contributes directly to the competitivity of exports, so that all the points that I mentioned earlier of actually India being more self-reliant and actually ensuring that we actually grab the opportunity of decoupling from China, we will ensure that you know, some of these reforms have to be actually done going forward, right? So that, you know, we are able to actually cut this cost of logistics, right? As an example, you know, multimodalism is an extremely important aspect, right? I mentioned a little bit about the rail share piece, you know, going up during the COVID times. And you know, so one of the things that we can actually do to make rail more competitive as compared to road, for example, for the lower weight categories, is to make the rail freight slabs more competitive as compared to road, so that we are actually able to serve a larger base of goods and commodities by rail in that sense, right? We need to encourage coastal shipping and inland waterways, and, you know, and the industry speaking very, very closely with the government to ensure that some of these reforms that are needed to actually link the various modes of transport, so that an end-to-end, you know, supply chain can be delivered to a customer at ease. You know, Mr. Dinesh actually talked about, you know, the documentation for multimodalism as an example. I mean, these are things that we need to actually, you know, really, really do pretty quickly in order to actually ensure that the cost of logistics actually comes down in that sense. The second point I would say is skill development in that sense, right? Because efficiency is also something that we touched upon a little bit earlier in this discussion. You know, creation of the skilled and trained professionals for logistics sectors can make a huge, huge difference in terms of efficiency, right? And the CI Institute of Logistics, I've read a lot about it, and I've been also a bit, has also started this work on introducing logistic-related courses in education curriculum. And we need to also have these specific skill sets, which will enable our colleagues in the logistics industry to embrace the higher level of automation that is actually needed in our sector in that sense. And then the third point on the reforms, other than skill and multimodalism, is essentially the infrastructure, right? We need to improve the hinterland connectivity with between the ports and railways and roads in a much more coordinated manner going forward, right? Multimodal terminals at strategic locations, which are really well coordinated between the central, state government, and other stakeholders, so that, you know, we don't have actually duplication of capacity where it's not needed, for example, and scarcity of capacity where it is essentially needed in that sense, right? So we need to make sure that this multimodal terminals at strategic locations are actually well coordinated going forward. We also need to actually complete this dedicated freight corridor, which is linking north and west, and the upcoming one linking north and east in that sense, to come up really, really fast, because this can actually reduce the cost of logistics dramatically in that sense, right? We need to also include logistic parks in the master planning of SEZs, for example, right? And we need to improve PPP models to attract more private investments in the various logistics subsectors. And Mr. Pawan Kumar Agarwal is still not on the call, but you know, I just thought I'll touch a little bit about the Department of Logistics, which in the last year, 1.5 years, has played a very, very major role in taking out some of the bottlenecks that we actually saw earlier between the various sections of the government in that sense, and also between the stakeholders and the government in that sense. This can actually, the Department of Logistics can leverage its unique and very neutral position to cut across interfaces between different line ministries and coordinate on projects of national importance, such as multimodal national parks, you know, ports and expressways. It is essential that the Department of Logistics acts as a nodal agency for such projects for three key reasons, in my opinion, right? One is, of course, as I mentioned, the duplication of projects or overlap for the same cargo traffic that is avoided, and capacity creation is more realistically linked to the actual throughput. You know, this harmonious and holistic planning of projects, which is extremely, extremely important to reduce the cost of logistics and to ensure the standardization of processes and interfaces for both the physical as well as the digital systems between different logistics infrastructure. And I'm sure that, you know, under the excellent leadership of Mr. Pawan Kumar Agarwal, the Department of Logistics will take measures that will transform the India's logistics sector, and the much awaited national logistics will play a very, very major role in supporting that. With that, I would like to conclude my address. I look forward to a day full of interesting discussions and insights. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Thanks, Usman. Really appreciate all the comments. I think the infrastructure side as well, which you mentioned, is obviously something which I think we will hear more from Sanil Srivatsava as well, I assume. But I think we will continue to cover this, I'm sure. It's not something which is going to stop soon. So thank you for bringing out all of that. Can I now request Mr. Anil Srivatsava, who I think has been, if I can say so, involved in very many ways with the logistics sector, sir. I think you are the Joint Secretary in the Civil Aviation. I think you are Chairman Managing Director of Governance. So, and I think now you are the Mission Director of NITI Aayog for Infrastructure Connectivity, which is, I think, very relevant to what we have been discussing today. So we now eagerly look forward to hearing from you. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, we can.
Okay, okay. So sorry, you know, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir. I mean, you're not visible, but you're audible. I was just requesting.
I should be visible also. Just 1 minute. I should be visible also. Isn't that?
Now you're visible, sir.
According to my, yeah. Okay, it doesn't matter. So if I'm audible, I can.
You're also visible, sir. You're visible. You're visible.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful.
So I just was
so sorry for this.
No problem, sir.
But I was hearing a little bit of conversation. You know, I heard Rizwan, you know, Mr. Rizwan Sumar mention about the Department of Logistics. But I missed remarks by Mr. Dinesh and Mr. Janastha, you know, so I'll catch up with you to understand, you know, what you say, you know, words of wisdom. A very good morning to all of you, and thank you for inviting me, you know, on this platform. You know, as I think Mr. Dinesh and others must have mentioned that just 4-5 weeks into the job, and every day I'm learning new things. A few things that you know, I hear every day are multimodality, you know, which everyone talks about. We also talk about you know, how can we make our processes more efficient, documentation using electronic mode, ensure digital payments, so all these things are things that we keep hearing. One thing I'm becoming quite clear is that we all perhaps know what is required to be done. I think there is absolutely no confusion in anyone's mind on what is required to be done. I think what we have not been able to figure out is that how that will be done. And particularly it becomes more challenging because of the fragmented policy and regulatory space and highly disorganized logistics sector. So that makes it far more difficult to figure out how things can, how we can make things happen in a little structured manner. And I think this is what we are all struggling with. Now, what perhaps we can do is, I will talk about a few things that are under consideration of the government. And the first thing being to create a unified policy and regulatory space. And a unified policy and regulatory space requires three things, perhaps. One is, a body which will coordinate all these efforts. So in some sense, even if it is half baked, a logistics division in the Ministry of Commerce and Industry provides that coordination mechanism. Second is to create a document which will define those policies. And in that space, over the last 1.5-2 years, we have been working on the National Logistics Policy. And I may share with you that after joining a few weeks ago, I have had a complete look at it and talked to a wide range of stakeholders, including the related ministries, and taken on board comments and suggestions that we have received from the Prime Minister's office, from the Cabinet Secretariat and others. So now a revised draft, which appears to be, taking all the concerns and all ideas together, is now ready and will be taken up for approval. Third is that providing a unified regulatory space. And in that direction, as you may be aware that earlier there used to be a multi, or even today we have a multimodal transportation of goods act, and that takes care of only multimodal transportation as far as export is concerned. Now, since logistics, we are talking about domestic, export and import, all of it, so that was under revision. And when we were revising it, we realized that why not, transform it into a National Logistics Act. And that is on the anvil. And it is on this piece that we may require more ideas, more thoughts from you, that what this National Logistics Act should be all about. Apart from, obviously, creating those documents, the logistic documents, the multimodal document that was earlier referred to under the Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act. So we could perhaps think in terms of a unified or single logistic document that may be applicable for all modes of transport and perhaps for warehousing as well. And apart from that, another idea that has come up and is being examined is to create a unified, portal, which we are calling as the National Logistics Portal, or maybe India Logistics Portal, wherein all logistic players, all logistic providers are registered. Now the challenge is that as we go on to register these logistic service providers, and give them, you know, some recognition under a common law. So how do we deal with the registrations or licensing that is being done by different agencies as of now? And as we move forward, we will figure that out, that how that is to be handled, you know, and that is a, you know, a little tricky issue. So with some of these measures, which I do hope should be in place in the next few months, you know, we are going to provide a unified policy and regulatory space for the logistics sector. And I think that to me, along with the digital platform where the logistics service providers, transporters and others can interact seamlessly, you know, exchange documents, you know, make digital payments and perhaps create a marketplace, you know, for, you know, delivery of services to each other. And also that will basically bring in great efficiencies. I think with these measures in place, you know, we do see the logistics sector, a unified logistics sector coming to form in the country. The next piece is the multimodality. The multimodality, obviously, there is no intention either of the government or the logistics to take over responsibility of infrastructure development of different ministries. Our role can be essentially to nudge them, to support them, to enable that whatever infrastructure, transport infrastructure is being created, you know, that has multimodality built in there. You know, there are facilities for, you know, interchange, there are facilities for transshipment, you know, handling facilities are there. And, they, you know, most of the, particularly the big investment must be, you know, alive to the need for multimodality. And in that respect, you know, let me share with you, as we speak, you know, today itself, there are three major projects that are, you know, being considered by the government of India at the highest level. And there was a meeting about it 2 weeks ago, wherein this whole issue that while these projects are okay, but the logistics division was advised to look at the multimodality aspect of those projects, you know, in particular. And our team was engaged with the concerned transport ministries and also with the Department of Promotion for Industry and Trade, DPIIT, who is steering this proposal to look at the multimodality of these projects. I think if all big projects or projects above a certain threshold in the country, whether they come up through the central government or by the state government, if this aspect is particularly attended to while planning and while making investments, then I do hope that in future, our infrastructure that we built will have multimodality, you know, in their DNA. And that will help, you know, us to move into a multimodal transportation system. So with these measures, I do hope that logistics sector, that is, I think, one sector that requires a lot of attention, not only for reasons of efficiency and cost effectiveness, but also to provide competitiveness to Indian industry, Indian manufacturing sector. If we have, you know, about 10 lakh crore that can be unlocked by savings through logistic cost, I think that saving will give huge competitive advantage to the Indian manufacturing sector and to the Indian economy. So I think it is very, very important that we start working together. I think this is perhaps one of the sectors, more difficult sectors, wherein we continue to work in silos. We have to find ways of, you know, integrated investment and also working in the logistics sector And that is going to happen. You know, I'm very positive about it with the support of people, you know, and several of my good friends that I have made over the last few weeks. They are here today, Mr. Dinesh, Mr. Rizwan Sumer. You know, I can assure you that all these people are extremely committed and dedicated and are working hand in hand with the government to make that happen. And I look forward for your continued cooperation and support. We would like to see a lot of action in this space. You know, as we speak, we are also creating a more vibrant web page for the logistics division. So we are creating a digital presence of the logistics division, so that all of you can then connect, you know, more readily with us and provide us new ideas and new thoughts. I think my only small submission is that many of at times over the last few weeks, when I have interacted with some of you and people from the industry, I think they have been largely focused on issues arising from COVID-19. While I think we are all passing through extraordinary circumstances and those issues need to be addressed, but let me assure you that while these are being addressed, but let us look at a little more long term and focus our attention on addressing our medium to long term issues, give visibility to the logistics sector in the scheme of things. And that visibility had rightly come when the Honorable Prime Minister mentioned, you know, when he referred to Atmanirbhar Bharat supply chains several times in his speech. So that visibility of logistics and supply chain is very much there. Now, if we have our act together and, you know, provide solutions that are, you know, implementable, you know, I'm sure we will get the support of the government at the highest level. And we can make the sector more competitive, more visible, and more relevant for Indian economy. Thank you very much for giving me this platform. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think you are somebody whom I think within 6 weeks or 4 to 6 weeks of taking over has been, I would say, hyperactive in the right way. And I think we really appreciate that. And I think, as you said, we have been in continuous touch. But I think most importantly for all of us, we are now trying to, or we are first time getting the unified view, which I think you have already articulated. So we really look forward to continuing to interact with you. And thank you for giving us this wonderful address. Before I come to the conclusion, I think I would now request Mr. Anil Srivatsava, who's joined us, who is the Project Mission Director of from Niti Aayog. Mr. Srivatsava, can I now request you to give your address, please? Mr. Srivatsava?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Now we can hear you.
So I wished a very good morning to all of you at around 10 o'clock. And I have just to leave in about 2-3 minutes of time. So, and I'm glad that Pawan has covered all the issues which were to be talked about from on the government's behalf. But a few things I would like to say as to post-COVID or a pre-COVID, the logistics sector has been highly inefficient in our country. We may not accept it, but this is a matter of fact. Our logistic costs are very high, and we, as rightly said by the secretary, special secretary also, the departments do work in the silos. And as Professor Janat Shah also mentioned, that we had put rather the entire globe, unfortunately, put the eggs in one basket. While we bother about our supply chains, we do not get into the deeper. We do not bother about tier one, as the Professor Janat Shah said in his words. Yes, there's clearly a lack of centralized planning, and the working is in the silos, and there is a lot of integration which is required. Now, how the diplomatic relations are going to be coming forward after post-COVID, in post-COVID era, that is also to be looked into. We were talking about the globalization and the world is flat in terms of the Friedman's words, but now that the what shape the globalization is going to take place is also to be seen. We need to work with the Ministry of Railways, the Civil Aviation, the Shipping Ministry, Road Transport. These are the four different things, and it's a daily conversation which I used to find during my last 3 years tenure in the Niti Aayog, that the shipping ministry says that the approach road is not ready up to the berth, and then the railway says that the sidings are not made, and likewise, and the result of our turnaround time, whether it is the ship or whether it is the plane or the aircraft, it's all the one of the highest in the world. So the friends, we have to realize as to what we are wanting and how are we going to handle it, and the kind of coordination which is needed. We were talking about massive disruptions in the energy and the mobility sector. Then the mobility includes the freight and the logistics. The major disruption which were talked about was the batteries, the electrification of the mobility, the transport as a service, autonomous vehicles, and redundancy of grid, etc. So these were the 5-6 major disruptions which we were talking about pre-COVID times. Now, what are the going to be the disruptions? Meanwhile, the COVID has created the one of the biggest disruptions, and then we have to handle the situation post-COVID. Some of the suggestions, because I'm running short of time, some of the suggestions I would like to say is that we need to handle the entire situation in such a way that we can move the industry, that we can move the logistics sectors in the desired direction. And for that, extensive planning on behalf of the finance ministry or has to be planned, and there has to be some kind of a playing. I'm using the word playing with the duty regimes and the taxation regimes for moving the industry in the desired directions, along with the coordination with different ministries and the departments. Now, these kind of things are being played, these things are being used by various countries in order to improve the efficiencies and improve the things in the various countries. And our neighbor, eastern neighbor China and the northern neighbor, have been foremost in that to move forward. Now, we can't have the policies, we can't have the planning, which goes for years. Even the policy making takes years in our country, which is extremely unfortunate. Why do we need the policy? We don't need policies to be efficient. We don't need policies for the integration. We don't need policies for the coordination of various ministries and the departments. So friends, we keep waiting for the policies. And I remember that earlier the people were talking about, while I was trying to push the electric vehicle movement, people were talking about the FAME policy or the subsidy policy and the policies for the electric vehicles. And I used to wonder as to what is it that is meant by the policy for the electric vehicles, because electric vehicles in itself is comprises of 5-6 different departments and the ministries where the coordination is needed. So these are some of the pertinent points which come to my mind. I wish success to this conference, and I thank all of you for giving me this opportunity to express myself. Thanks a lot, and best wishes.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your inputs. I think we will keep coming back to you for advice and support as and when we need it. Really appreciate your time for having come on board and joining us. Can I now request Mr. Mohan to give his closing remarks?
Mr. Anil Srivastava, Principal Consultant and Mission Director, Niti Aayog, Government of India. Mr. R. Dinesh, Chairman, CII Institute of Logistics Advisory Council and Managing Director, DBS Supply Chain Solutions Limited. Mr. Rizwan Sumer, Chairman, CII National Ports and Shipping Committee and Managing Director, India Subcontinent, DP World. Professor Jannat Shah, Member CII National Committee on Logistics and Director of IIM Udaipur. Distinguished speakers, invitees, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It's a privilege and honor for me to give the concluding remarks into the inaugural session of the Baltic Summit. On behalf of CII and on my personal behalf, I take immense pleasure in thanking Mr. Pawan Kumar Agarwal, Special Secretary of Logistics, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India, for his presence at this in the midst of his eventful schedule. Mr. Agarwal, touched upon very important points. I think the creation of a unified policy and unified policy and regulatory space is in itself a very, very strong initiative by the Government of India. The other important interesting comment that I heard was the multimodality should become the DNA, in everything that we do, and should become really, the infrastructure should lend itself towards multimodality, because that's really the future to reduce cost as well as improve efficiency and to become a, kind of a pretty good alternative to industry, even for international players to come into India and look at India as a very positive destination. Lastly, I think I was very impressed with the digital presence of logistics division. It's the kind of logistics division is looking to enhance the engagement in the industry, and that also is going to help exchange ideas and views, and there is going to be a free flow of information and comments. So I think thank you very much, sir. You're very, very helpful and very, very progressive, I must say. Very, very constructive and progressive. I would also like to thank Mr. Anil Srivastava, Principal Consultant and Mission Director of DPIO, Government of India, for his valuable time and participation. I know it was, he had a very short time, but he had very strong views about the logistics sector, the current state of it, as well as how how we should accelerate what we plan to do as a country, and strong opinion on policy requirements not being necessarily the driver for making changes. And I think disruption issues, very, very strong views on from Mr. Anil Srivastava. I think once again, he looked at driving the industry in the right direction, and that was very, very interesting. I think at a very macro level, this is what is required. I mean, some kind of a long-term thinking, which is also directionally correct for us in the next 5-10 years, which is also very important. And Mr. Agarwal also spoke about that, saying that while we are in a crisis, we should also be looking long term and work towards Atmanirbhar Bharat. While it is not a slogan, more I think it's a thought process for the country, and I think it needs to be taken very, very seriously and worked upon in terms of policy and practice both. Like to thank Professor Janas Shah. I think Janas Shah started by saying, what way is COVID different from any other calamities in the past? I think, interestingly, he summed it very nicely by saying it's scale, scope, and pace. It's never happened in the world. I mean, that's the scale. The scope is it's covered everybody, and the pace at which has happened is just 2 or 3 months, and it's decimated pretty much all the economies at the same time, because demand and supply both have been affected. I think it's just a completely unprecedented, and yes, I think a lot of heads of states and the CEOs, managing directors, are all talking about logistics as a real function, and the global focus on supply chain management and its concentration which was there before is definitely going to get disrupted now. Going forward, everybody is going to think of 2 or 3 alternatives to everything that they do. And I think that in itself is going to drive a different dynamics in the way industry is going to develop, in the way logistics is going to develop. And it's a very interesting thought there. I'll also thank Mr. Rizwan Suma, Chairman of the Ports and Logistics Committee and Managing Director of India Subcontinent DP. Mr. Sumer actually said a very, very positive thing which I had not heard before, that the railways played a very important role during lockdown. I mean, that's very heartening to hear, because normally, you know, we think that railways is not so efficient and very cumbersome, you know, from a movement of material point of view. But that was really good in terms of where we are. And again, his thoughts were also simple, you know, that can India become an alternative location for companies internationally? And what do we need to do, you know? And multimodalism, which Mr. Agarwal also spoke, was also touched upon by Mr. Sumer. And of course, the clear challenge for us on a day-to-day basis for everybody in the industry is going to be the demand vagary. How are you going to make your operations fairly elastic in trying to deal with it on a day-to-day basis. Now, when you're coming out of COVID, or even later, when the whole new normal is there. I'd like to thank Mr. Dinesh, Chairman, CIS, Logistics Advisory Council and Managing Director, PBS Supply Chain Solutions, for your splendid enlightenment on this topic. I think you opened it extremely well in terms of saying what the new normal is going to look like, and that the industry itself is going to go and transform itself to where we think everything will have to be done differently, and we will kind of start to identify ourselves in terms of business processes, efficiency, so on and so forth, right? So I'd like to thank Mr. K.V. Mahidhar, Executive Director, CIF, for organizing this digital event. Also very thankful to KPMG for designing this conference theme and session for this digital conference. I would be failing on my duty if I'm not thanking our supporters. I think, you know, we've had supporters to sponsor this event. You know, this first stop digital event, I think, you know, Institute of Logistics is going into the first stop digital event. And through the year, I'm told, is going to be, we'll continue this process. You know, I thank TVS Supply Chain Solutions, Bomber Group, DP World, Godrej Consevo, Logistics Automation Limited, Leeladhar Paso, Etos Partners, Arnus Piney Storage Solutions, Freight Systems, and Safe Express. So we have very eminent speakers who are present here to share their experience at this conference. I'm sure this will be an excellent learning experience for all of us. I wish Logistics 2020 a great success. I think the first DC conference is being held at the Institute of Logistics. And I thank you very much once again for being with us today and for, you know, sharing your thoughts. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mohan. I think